Well, hey everybody, it's Jeff Lafferty and Scott Circlin today, ArtCast 239. What's going on, Scott?
Good, how are you, Jeff?
I'm pretty good. Pretty good. I was just saying that we actually started, it must be late today because it's actually already 9 here, so.
Yeah, eight over here, so.
Yeah.
Daredevil's looking good. I really still like that texture. So do you purposely, like, not put texture where you're going to paint the figure, or how do you do that?
I can't really draw on that stuff, so I got to be careful where I stick it. I can paint on it, but I can't color pencils across it.
Yeah. Because I know, like, when I do, like, murals and stuff, it's usually on a texture wall, which painting's fine, but like you said, the drawing, it's difficult.
Yeah.
Looks like Jake.
Oh, yeah. The ones that we were talking about that in the chat yesterday, when you weren't on, those murals in your office or your studio there or whatever. How'd you get those up there? Did you draw those up there? Or did you project them up there?
Project them. Like what I would do, like for the superhero one, I just went online and I always tell this to people, and this goes back to that whole debate you guys were having before about reference and stuff like that. When you're drawing stuff like licensed characters and things like, well, I mean, I guess it's different for you. I mean, you can do it, but like for me, like if you want to get it on model and you want it to get it look right, I mean, you're never, if you're doing Disney or something, it's better to project it, because I've seen so many people try to do like Disney characters freehand, and they're like deceptively simple. I mean, you think they're easy to draw, but they aren't, because you have to get them so perfect. And unless you're like Disney animator, where you're constantly drawing these characters over and over again, just a little bit off, it just doesn't look right. So I'll just find the pictures and trace them for stuff like that. And
yeah.
So what I did with the superhero mural, I just basically went online and found a bunch of pictures of, superheroes and poses and stuff that I like, and then just a collage in Photoshop. Like, arranged them how I wanted them. And I knew what I wanted. I knew I wanted it to be like Marvel side and the DC side facing off. So, you know, I tweaked a few things here and there, but for the most part, you know, I just found pictures I liked, and then Photoshop made a collage. And then I had to shrink it down fairly small because my projector can only hold, like I think it's like a 5x, I don't know what it is. It's like a postcard size or whatever picture.
Yeah.
So shrunk it down and then projected it with my opaque projector on the wall, and then traced it and then painted it and all that. So that's kind of the problem.
That's cool. I mean, I got nothing against projectors, and especially like any kind of mural thing. I've done a couple, and that's how I got the image up there. Yeah, I couldn't imagine trying to draw something.
Yeah, because the scale is, I'm not used to drawing at that scale. So there's like, you know, it would be so off and everything. It would take me twice as long if I had to like try to freehand it. So.
Yeah. Yeah, like you said, just to keep the proportions and to be like, whoo. Looks like the chat's rocking. Lindro is in there. Timothy Phillips is in there. Bumpy Knuckles. Super Killer likes my Daredevil. So thanks, man. Yeah.
Looks like Jay dropped out again.
Oh, was he in there?
He was in there real quick. I saw him.
He came in and saw you in here, Scott, and he's just like, nope.
Yeah. I'm trying to catch up on all the videos I missed. I've watched a few of them, but I think there's probably a couple. Because I know you did one on Saturday that I haven't seen yet, and then the one I missed yesterday. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So you still watch every show, huh? Even though you're on it?
Oh, yeah.
That's pretty wild.
You know, usually listen to while I'm drawing and stuff, but now it's like just there's so much catching up to do that now I've got all, since I was kind of away doing the convention, there's all these other videos and stuff I'm trying to catch up on.
Yeah, there's like a couple guys in like the 100 Days of Comics thing that, you know, I don't know what it is, like when they upload or whatever, but it just happens to be like when I'm setting the show up. And so I've been listening to like them in the mornings, which is, it's kind of cool because I hadn't listened to any of the 100 Days of Comics much since like you guys stopped, you know. I was like listening to Kevin's, but
yeah,
like I used to listen to yours like religiously, and then trying to think who else. I guess Peter. But there were some others. Gazbot, I guess.
Yeah.
But yeah.
Kind of so who do you watch? Because I was going to start watching a bunch of them, and I noticed I started clicking on them, and it looked like a lot of them weren't doing videos. And you know, to me, it's the videos are easy for me to ingest because I'm working and I can have them on. Whereas the blog post things are a little harder. So, but I went because there's tons of people doing it, but it seems like as many people were doing videos before, that's how many people are doing like blog posts and stuff. So it's kind of it seems like it's kind of switched to more of a blog post thing. But there's a few people doing videos, so I was just curious who you were watching.
Well, yeah, that's the two that seem to like upload in the mornings for whatever reason. It's like that string cheese guy.
Yeah, actually, he's local here, so I met him at the convention.
And yeah, I was gonna say that he actually talked about you on like a video two back, seeing you at Phoenix, which was neat.
Yeah, I gotta catch up on his. I got up to like he was getting close to 50, and then like I went through most of his because I was way behind on videos, and then I caught up to him, and now I got some more catching up to do. So,
and then this other guy, I'm not even sure what his name is. He's like a big giant guy, the big old red brown kind of beard. I think his name's Ox or something.
Oh yeah, I think I saw. Did he just start recently, or was he one of those guys that had been doing it but didn't really promote himself, and then kind of got on the?
I think maybe, you know, like that's it. He just maybe just didn't promote himself or something, and then because he's like right at about the same number as that other guy. He's like in his 50s already, so. But yeah, he's like, it looks like he's got a book out or something. He was like talking about bagging up some books, and he just kind of, you know, he's real nonchalant about everything. So he just like, you know, and I haven't really went back and watched all of his videos, but he just kind of like will lift it up really quick and then drop it back down. So you can't quite tell what's going on, but
yeah,
I don't know. It's just fun listening to people create and stuff. So
yeah, I'll have to check that out.
Yeah. It's neat how it's going on, you know, taking on its own life in a way, you know.
You there, Jay?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, it's weird though. I got two icons. I got your little profile pic with the Joker, and then I've got a picture.
I know.
I got a picture of your painting. So
It's weird. When I turned on my computer this morning, it said that Chrome had updated the Hangout app, and now it's just acting all goofy on me.
Huh.
Well, that's weird. They're not trying to make you take that Windows 10, are they?
I have no idea. I know I've been trying for a couple of minutes to get on here, and it just wouldn't let me get on.
Yeah. The pain, yeah. Like, I have this little icon that won't go away. That's where they're trying to get me to, like, switch over to Windows 10. But I'm just like, I know that once I do it, something's going to stop working. So I'm like, I just don't want to bother with that.
Oh, definitely, yeah.
You know,
so weird. Jay, I have a question for you. So you and we kind of talked about this before, but so you said you got some prints done from Vistaprint, right?
Yes. Yeah.
What did you say you paid for those?
Off the top of my head, I'm thinking it was like $280 each. I think it came to.
Okay, now was that with a discount? Because I'm looking at their website.
Yeah, that was with the discount. Like they got one of their 40% discounts.
You know? Okay, got it. Because I'm looking and I'm seeing one for $5, which is more than I'm paying. So and it's a smaller.
Yeah, because when it starts off as like they're all like, you know, you can get one for like I think here it's one for $4.97
right.
or $5, but I ordered them in lots of $5, like the different designs in lots of $5, and with the 40% off, it came to just under $3.
Yeah, that's usually what I do. So I just got to find a 40% off coupon. I've seen them. I mean, they offer them to me all the time.
It's just a sales code. Christ, I got like 10 of them I could give you right now if you wanted to. You just enter it in when you go to the checkout.
Yeah, I'm not ready. I think I might just get one. I want to get one, just like probably one or a couple of my 3D ones just to see how theirs look, because I'm still trying to get that 3D to work right. So.
Yeah.
And as far as the... It's not like that real thin. Is it that real thin poster, like the actual posters, like that you see in like the movie lobbies and stuff?
Well, you have two options. You can get that, or you upgrade to the 200-pound, and I upgraded to the 100-pound.
Okay.
It's called their premium paper, I think.
Right. And I also noticed you can't get like the matte or the luster finish unless you order like the big giant prints or bigger posters.
Yeah, because it says glossy on it, but it's really not glossy. It's just like a satin finish.
Okay. All right, that's cool. That's cool.
That's neat, yeah. So I don't write like the real glossy ones. They look like photos almost.
Yeah, I was kind of concerned about it when I ordered them, but I figured, you know, I really wanted to see the print quality, and yeah, it's definitely not glossy. I'd almost call it a matte finish, to be honest.
Oh, that's cool. Oh. So just, all right. That's kind of what I needed to know. So now I can look into it a little more. And I was trying to see if I got the 24 by 36 and like, but it jumps way up. Like if I cut those in half, it's still going to be way more than if I order like, you know, 11 by 17 or something like that.
Yeah.
So, anyway.
Like I say, for like the really big poster prints, you know, they might not be the greatest deal, but for the 11 by 17, it's definitely price-wise and quality-wise, I'm not going to find anything better here for myself, I can tell
yeah.
you that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty cheap prints. I'm surprised the deal they're giving now.
And they're fast too. Like, I mean, I just got another batch in yesterday, and you know, from order to delivery to the door, it's what was it, 4 days?
That's awesome.
That's cool. You know.
Yeah, it's nice when it's like that. You know.
Yeah.
Instead of I don't know, I always think of like Kablam. You know, it's such a pain to get a book out of those guys. You know, it's just like a month.
they're getting a lot better, actually.
Yeah.
The last one I did didn't take that long.
It didn't?
Mm-mm, no, it took a couple weeks.
Well, that's good.
And that was kind of con season, too, so I think they, you know, they probably get enough, you know, people complaining about that they worked on it, so.
Yeah. Yeah, because like when the like conventions were really going to full swing, I remember like right before San Diego, it was like you couldn't freaking get anything from them, you know?
Yeah.
But I guess, you know, they're not Amazon either. You gotta like take that into account. They don't have hundreds of people just waiting to ship your stuff. But. So anyway, Gibran's in the chat. I want to say hi to him. He buys stuff from me sometimes. And Superkiller says that he's got that Windows 10 icon as well, and there's no way he's getting on that, and I agree. I wish I could just get rid of it. I try to just get rid of it, and it's somewhere in there, and I can't, you know what I mean? I don't want to dig too deep.
Yeah, I don't even have, like, Windows 8. I just don't like the, and I guess there is no Windows 9. I don't know what that's all about, but.
Like, yeah, what happened to 9? I don't remember.
I don't like the touch. I mean, if I had a touchscreen monitor, it might be all right. But I don't like it. Just does not. I can't get used to the touchscreen aspect of it when it's not a touchscreen monitor. You know.
Yeah, totally. I'm not.
Well, I mean, my computer. I got Windows 8, and it's got like all those touch apps and whatever. But there's a program I downloaded, so it actually makes it look like Windows 7, and it gets rid of all that crap.
Right. I think because on one my kid's computer has that, and I think they have something that makes it more like 7. But
like to look at it, I can't tell the difference between this and Windows 7, which is nice.
I wonder which one I got. I probably got Windows 7 would be my guess. So that's really scary. I'm gonna go clear from 7 to 10.
Yeah, but I mean on it, like I know well Windows. From everything I've read, the 10 is just an upgraded version of Windows 8. I really don't mind Windows 8. It's just kind of the layout of it that I didn't really dig. So, yeah, there's a program that just makes it look like Windows 7.
Yeah. Remember, like, who was on here? It was that other guy who streams on Picardo sometimes, Eric Webb.
Yeah.
And he was, like, talking about updates at one point, because I think there was some other update I got that screwed my computer up. a while ago. And he actually has it, it's like just turned off. Which I've always been scared to just completely turn them off, but...
Yeah, I don't think that would be a good thing to do either.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm always worried that, like, that, you know, if I turn it off, then there'll be some crazy virus out there that, you know, I'll end up with because I, you know, didn't get some crazy update.
Yeah, Windows is just evil.
Yeah. Oh, no.
Yeah, I've got...
Lindro actually asked, are you doing the Poison Ivy piece and that piece you're working on at the same time?
No, the Poison Ivy's done. It's listed. It's already got some bids on it. So.
There you go, man. Good job, Jay. And, by the way, do you, any of you guys make their own improvised camera holders?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, you know Scott will, yeah.
Right. Mine is like, it's so ghetto. It's like, it's just a bunch of PVC put together, and it's just kind of lodged in between the desk and my wall. So eventually I want to build something. I've seen people, what you can do, and I've seen videos where they buy one of those adjustable lamps, like the art lamps, either with mm-hmm. a base or a little, and then they just take the lamp part off and use the arm, and then they mount.
Yeah, that's what I got. I got it off eBay. It's a cell phone holder, and it's just got like this clamp on it, and I put my webcam in it. I think I paid like $5 for it.
That's cool. You love that PVC, Scott.
Yeah, you can go across
the PVC, man.
Yeah.
The apocalypse happens. You live in a PVC cave. Yeah, mine looks like a stick. I got, you know, taped to my desk. I tried that thing where, you know, like you guys says, you know, like to the arm. I've got a lot of broken lamps and stuff. And,
yeah.
You know, had it attached here and then hooked the camera to it. But I didn't like how, you know, it, if it's like hooked to my table in any way, like when I'm drawing, it'll kind of shake. It'll give that shimmy.
But, oh,
I also, I mean, I've got that arm that, you know, I paid like $150 or something. The one that I remember when I had the drawing tablet. Well, I kept the arm because eventually I'll get a new drawing tablet. But
that would work.
So I've got that. I mean, it's like heavy duty too. But it's kind of
totally work.
It's kind of behind, sort of behind one of my monitors, and I'd have to move my monitor every time. You know, I want to put it over my artwork, so now it's just easier to put this PVC thing on.
So, Tim, I don't know what Dee Dee meant, but she says, I do, Jeff. I have 10 minutes YouTube on it. Well, I don't quite know where she came in with that, but explain that a little bit, Dee Dee. And then Lindro says, I made one of my own from old printer spare parts yesterday. What? Maybe I'm, like, lost here.
Are they still talking about the camera rig?
I wonder. No, it is the camera. It says it's a little unstable, but it works. From printer parts?
Hmm, that's interesting.
I must be talking about Dee Dee's thing, because they're saying, like, what's the brand of, like, some pin she uses in one of her videos. And Dee Dee says, camera setup, Jeff. I guess I'm lost. And Lindro says it can actually change the height of the plastic arm.
That's cool.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, at one point I got really, like, you know, inspired to make, like, a really good one that kind of hangs over, and then the art would be nice and straight and all that kind of stuff. And but I don't know. I didn't like it. It stuck out, and I always felt like I was going to kill myself when I was going to sit down. And took it down and just went back to my old system.
Well, whatever works.
Yeah, that's the way I look at it. It's been good enough so far, so.
I did buy, I bought a couple new mics. I bought, like, one of the, you know, the ones that'll cancel out all the noise in the background and everything.
Yeah, that's neat.
And I also bought, like, a lavalier mic.
Right.
What was it called, a lavalier mic?
Yeah, it's the one that you, like, hook to your lapel or whatever, so, like,
oh, okay.
There's one thing, like, when I'm doing these videos, especially like if I'm doing like the one, the either like the mad, what do I call it, mad props, or the pro versus con, where sometimes I'm a little further away from my camera, which is my phone.
Yeah.
And so the volume, sometimes it's louder, sometimes it's shorter, or like shouting, or so now I'll have that, so the volume should be consistent throughout anytime I do a, you know.
Yeah.
Have you tried it out?
I haven't got it yet. I ordered it on Amazon, so.
Yeah, I was going to say, because I got one of those, like, when I was doing videos, you just got to make sure that you get the 4-pin and not the 3-pin.
What do you mean by that?
If you're going to use it in your cell phone, like with the 4-pin, that's where when you plug it into the speaker thing, the 4-pin will let the phone recognize if it's a microphone or a headphone.
Oh, okay.
If you just stick in the 3-pin, it won't work. It'll just think it's a headphone, and it won't work as a microphone.
Oh, that's good. Well, yeah, I don't know about that. I didn't pay a whole lot for it, but it did get decent reviews. It was a Sony, and it was stereo, not mono, which you kind of like. So,
yeah. Well, hopefully it should be fine, yeah.
Yeah, I
learned that one the hard way, because I had ordered one, the first one I ordered off eBay, and it was a 3-pin, and it wouldn't work, and I couldn't figure it out. And then I Googled it. It was like, oh, I need a 4-pin.
Hmm. Yeah, I also ordered the PowerDirector software.
Oh, cool.
So
now we're going to get, like, Michael Bay
I don't know.
Videos from you.
Explosions.
I don't know about that. Well, the thing is, I mean, there's different versions of it, and I did get I got one of the Artcasters, like, sent me a link and everything. I hope it wasn't, like, an affiliate link where they would have made money because I didn't order it from that link. because I looked at the price, and it was a good price, but it was kind of what I had seen it before, and there's different versions of it. Right. But like the deluxe version or whatever they're calling it, it's got a lot of extra stuff, but it's like nothing that I would probably use. Like it's got a holiday package and a wedding package, you know, just different effects for that kind of stuff, which I'll never use that. I don't like to get carried away with all the pre-done like special effects and stuff, because it to me it, a lot of times it cheapens it, because most of those effects are pretty bad.
So. Yeah.
I just want the basic thing where there's certain things I want to be able to do that I can't do in Windows Movie Maker, and you know, should be able to do it all with this one.
That's pretty cool. I've never used that program, but it sounds neat. It's any little step up will help, probably.
Yeah, you got Sony Vegas though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a pretty decent software from what I hear. So you could probably do all that stuff, all the stuff that I'd be able to do through that.
Oh, I'm sure you can do like a ton of stuff in Sony. So. Yeah, and then like once you get that lapel microphone, you want to have to, you know, get your kids to like stand on the chair and hold the boom mic for you anymore.
So I saw you, you're at the drive-in movies last night on Picardo.
That's right.
You were, Jeff?
No, I was on Picardo, and I was, like, streaming, and I had the first Sinbad going this time.
The really first good Sinbad.
One. Yeah, the seventh.
The one with the Cyclops?
Yeah, the one with the Cyclops and the dragon in the end. Yeah. Which I realized something just watching that movie is, like,
special effects are horrible.
No,
Harryhausen, man, don't.
I like those ones, but yeah, it's like Sinbad's kind of like a dick in that movie, because you know it's like he gets that guy, you know, like the wizard's like lamp, you know, like in the beginning, and then he just won't give it back to him, like no matter what happens, you know. It's like every time the guy, you know, he just keeps making deal after deal. You know, it's like, no, we got to go to the island, and then I'll give you the lamp back. And then they get to the island, and he's like, now I got to get safely back to the boat, and then I'll give you the lamp back.
I can barely even remember it. Man.
Yeah. But he's just like, and then he never gives it back to him, because eventually the guy tries to kill him. And you can't blame him, because he won't give him the lamp, so... I don't know. It's a good one, man.
Rewatch those. I haven't seen those since I was a kid.
I'll just jump on Jeff's Picardo channel. I'm sure it'll still be.
Yeah, well, everybody else has copyright infringement city on there, so I thought, what the hell? I don't know. I was so freaking tired last night. I don't know why I even did that.
What time were you doing? That must have been pretty late.
I started at midnight. So
that's like, what, 2 o'clock my time?
Okay. Yeah. I looked for you on there. You didn't seem to be on.
Nah, I was going to turn it on, and then I kind of figured, nah. I put up like a little banner, though, so now on my screen it says, you know, when I'm offline, and it's got a picture of some of my artwork on it. So.
Yeah, I saw that little, you know, that looks so much better.
Yeah.
That's a really nice piece you put a picture of on there, too. Man.
Yeah, I figure at least if people look at it when I'm not on, it might interest them to come back later.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
You still have that one that you got that was on there? I don't remember seeing it.
Yeah, that's one of the... Oh, God, I'm tongue-tied. One of the pieces for the book, so I still got that.
Yeah. That's a nice piece.
Like I say, there's a guy that wants to buy it, though, so I'm still considering if I should hang on to it or just unload him now.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's kind of tough. Like, I don't want to... Comes time for the book, and if I have to re-photograph something and I don't have the piece around, I'd be pretty pissed off at myself.
Also, you know what? Once you get that book out, you may be able to get a higher price for it, because if it's actually a published piece...
Yeah, I'm thinking about that, too. Like I said, there's one really good customer of mine, and he pretty much said, you know, just put together a price, and that's what I'll pay. It's like, ooh, it's tempting.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it looks like that guy Gary Anderson was the guy who gave you the link.
Hey, Gary, was that an affiliate link? If it was, again, I'm sorry, I didn't buy it through that.
It says you owe me 37 cents. No. it says no worries, Scott. The link was from the goodness of my heart.
Cool. Yeah, because the good thing is because I have Amazon Prime, so a lot of times I can just order from Amazon and you know, not have to pay the shipping. And although that one, if I would have got it through that website, it was just a digital download. But
so Dee Dee said something. She says this thing called Minicam.
Is that the one I had? I don't know. Go ahead. Sorry.
Says if you wanting to use multi cameras, there's a software called Minicam. Does that mean it's just like films different cameras, like from your laptop cam and then your webcam or something?
Well, the one I got, the PowerDirector does have multiple cameras. You can hook up to 4 different cameras. So, and what it does, it's really cool. It just syncs it all by the audio. So I could have, like, if I'm doing like a show and I've got one camera that's close up on me, one that's kind of far away, or like if you're doing more than one person or whatever. You film them, you know, simultaneously, and then it syncs it by the audio.
That is cool. That's really
cool. It just recognizes where the audio is, and it'll put it all on 2 timelines, and then you just decide when you want to go from one cam to the other.
That's kind of neat. Yeah, see, like, when I film, like, with Sony, I just film my footage, and then I never film into Sony. I'd never thought about trying that. Like, I always just import it after it's all filmed and then edit it there, you know.
Yeah, because I could have, if I'm doing like a drawing video, I could have one on my artwork and one on me and switch back and forth if I wanted to. Or.
And that's like in that PowerDirector?
Yeah.
That's interesting. Hmm.
Yeah, you're going to start putting out some crazy videos.
Well, the problem is, I don't want to get too crazy because it takes so much longer. I mean, just because you can do it doesn't mean you really have the time to do it, but. You know, the main thing is, like, I want to do a cool intro for some of these new videos I'm going to be doing. So that's all like a one-time thing, you know, put some time into that, and then the rest of it just, you know, the quality should be a little better. But some of these guys, that's how they make their living is from YouTube. They can afford the time to do that. But
yeah,
I still got to try to find work and pay for all this stuff, so.
I guess I always thought that Minicam meant you could, like, stream to different webcam sites or something. I didn't realize it meant different cameras. Dee Dee says she's doing hers all live. Except for the YouTube videos. And then, upload to YouTube, no editing. She's so proud of that. She's like, you stream, just like, does it on the... I don't have to do anything. Yeah, but you gotta be on Ustream, though. That's the bummer part.
Yeah.
Oh, just kidding.
There's all these new streaming things. There's that Meerkat I keep hearing so much about.
Yeah.
I saw Marshall was doing stuff on there. I think you guys may have talked about it, but I haven't, you know.
Yeah, like I said, I can't get it to work because, like, that Meerkat and, like, Periscope and those sites, they're for like, Android and, like, iOS system, like, you know, cell phones and tablets. That's all they're for, but I tried to download the Meerkat, and my phone's only a year old, and it says that my phone can't do it. Like, I have to have a newer phone.
Really?
Huh. Yeah, so that's it. I don't know. I figure anything is streaming on there, there's a lot of people that won't be able to see it, you know, like me.
So you actually have to watch it on your phone, too, I guess.
Yeah.
Because I thought it said it worked through Twitter. Which I know you guys aren't on Twitter, but
yeah, I'm not on Twitter, so maybe, yeah, that might be a way to get on it. Yeah, because I tried looking if there was a website for it, and there's not.
The Meerkat?
Yeah.
It sends you somewhere when you click that link. I don't know if it's the website, but
yeah, Marshall was doing some cool videos. Do you see the one he did where he started drawing, like, characters from Fury Road?
Yeah, I watched that one.
And then all of a sudden he said, let's switch it up. And then he started drawing a bounce house around him where they were all jumping in a bounce house.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That was pretty neat. He just threw another one up. I wonder if this Meerkat's like DD and Ustream, or they can just throw it, like, you know, they'll just pull it right over to YouTube. Or if it's actually not. Yeah.
Because I started watching some videos on it, but it looks like it's kind of the thing where it broadcasts live and then it goes away unless you decide to record it or post it or something. So.
Okay.
Which it looks like that's what Marshall's doing because he's reposting like Facebook. That's where I saw it. But, you know, I just got to find something else because I think if you are one of the early adopters to one of these, it might be good. But it's just, you know, Facebook is almost useless to me now. I'm so upset because I concentrated so much time on that stupid thing, and now it's like it's useless.
Yeah, something to think about. And I agree, it is useless. I almost think that if they see that you get traction, because I noticed, like, I was actually getting, like, more hits off my like the fan page there. And it seems to almost like I pulled it back, you know, like, no, you're getting too much attention there,
right.
You know, because I noticed it just seems to have just super died. And like my last post, it said like 18 people saw it or something. And you're just like, you suck, Facebook. You know,
y'all got to jump over to the dark side.
Well, I'm on Instagram, but I you know. I'm not like you on Instagram, Jay. I mean, you don't post you really don't post that much on Instagram.
Nah, maybe like twice a week.
Yeah, so, I mean,
it's the Jay.
Well, it's, you know, it's the artwork. I mean, it's, you know, I'm always like showing his stuff to people because it's unbelievable. Everyone's saying, that's airbrushed? You know, I thought that was a photograph, so it's, you know, I always pull his stuff up on Instagram.
Yeah. Now I can see that. Yeah, especially like a photo or something when it's on his easel, you know, unless he's got a hand in there or something. It's like, you know, take a little of the detail of the painting out, and man, that thing does look like a photo.
Yeah, so I always got to put like my airbrush and my pencils and shit in the pictures just so people know it's the painting. Well, I'm sure something else will come along, you know. I mean, Christ, even Instagram's been around for a little while. I'm sure there'll be some new social media explosion on the horizon.
Yeah. I'm sure, you know, I'm sure something will eventually take out Facebook, but who knows.
It would just be nice if Facebook would pull their heads out of their ass and just fix it, make it the way it was.
If there was some way they could do something different from, I mean, I understand that, you know, they've given us this tool and, they, you know, they, well, not like they're not making money, but they've got to find a way to monetize it, but it's just, you can't be like a grassroots, the whole thing before, you could do grassroots, and, I mean, if there's different some way to differentiate like the big companies that can afford like the advertising budget from, you know, the smaller people that just it's just they can't. I mean it's not worth it. I mean I'm sure it's great for, you know, IBM and companies like that who can afford to pay for, you know, all this advertising, but
yeah.
Artists, there's no way, it's not worth it.
I know. And, you know, it's like, I mean, I don't know, you know, not everybody does it that way. YouTube doesn't do it that way. You know, there's like a ton of free platforms that can make money without, you know, that kind of shenanigans, you know, I don't know. I wish something else would come along and kind of replace it, but not yet anyway. Who knows, maybe Instagram will do it.
Who knows?
And then, we're talking about Meerkat now. Dee Dee said she wasn't on Meerkat. I saw that message go by a little while ago. And what are they saying? Yeah, I don't know. I haven't been over that one yet, so. You guys want to do the next Arcast on Meerkat? Can we pull that
off? It sounds like it's more of a cell phone thing, so you might have issues with that.
Man. Well, I actually haven't been able to watch a fucking Meerkat video of his, so I don't quite understand, like, what the benefit of, like, getting on, which I guess you guys are on Instagram, it's the same thing, but what's the point of going somewhere where, like, everybody can't look? I guess that's going to be the new trend, though. Everybody's saying bye, we're not leaving. What's going on in there? Well, maybe Dee Dee's leaving. Like popular, golly. She comes in, everybody starts talking to her. Oh no, Tim's taking off. Never mind. It's hard to keep up with the chat sometimes. Things goes by pretty quick.
Yeah.
Especially when I'm trying to paint.
Yeah, it was funny, last night for a little bit, I was checking out yesterday's cast.
Yeah.
Yeah, like the camera locked on you for the whole show.
Really?
Yeah.
That's fucked. I'm not doing that today, am I?
I have no idea.
I'm seeing it switch.
That's a drag. I wonder if I clicked it and just didn't realize it.
Oh, probably. Not that I really care.
Yeah. No, I don't like that because it's just like, you know, when, for other people watching, though. Usually somebody will say that, though, in the show, in the chat, but... Wait, like, who was it? Was it just me and you yesterday?
Yeah. Yeah, because I was just trying to read through the comments. I was looking at the video and I was talking and it was still showing you painting Daredevil. I was like, oh, that's kind of weird.
Yeah. Well, there was one other time it did something like that where it got like, you know, I didn't click it, but it just got stuck or something.
Yeah.
But Dee Dee says it's switching today, so thanks, Dee Dee. Freaking Google.
Yeah, so after the show, I gotta drive into Toronto and pick up my undeliverable package.
Oh, man.
Undeliverable, why?
Well, I was checking the tracking on it, and it says it's in Toronto at undeliverable office and to call customer service. So last night and all this morning, I had the pleasure of trying to actually find a phone number for customer service for Canada Post. Holy Jesus. I ended up getting it through Google. I couldn't even find it on the Canada Post site.
Jeez.
So I called them up, and they got the tracking number on it, and they're saying, like, well, there's no return address on it, and there's no address, no shipping address on it. I'm thinking, well, that's impossible, because I taped the shit out of those things. Like, there's no way that that address isn't on there.
Man, yeah. So, like, somehow the address got pulled off it?
Yeah, and they're saying, like, well, they need the original receipt to give it to me. It's like, oh, Christ, so I got to drive down there, and someone's going to get hell.
Yeah, what a fucking pain in the ass. Unbelievable,
I mean,
man.
Like, I scotch tape, you know, I print out the address and I scotch tape it, like the packing tape, I should say, and I tape the shit out of it. There's no way that thing's coming off.
Yeah.
How far are you from Toronto?
Well, it's actually just outside Toronto. It's in Scarborough, so it's going to be a good 45 minutes to get there.
Jeez.
Yeah, I'm not impressed.
No.
You know, there's a painting inside it, so I got to get this thing back.
Yeah, totally. I hope the painting's not messed up or like whatever happened to the box to get that label off of there didn't affect.
Oh yeah, because the girl on the phone really wasn't telling me much. So
yeah,
that thing's damaged. Oh, you're gonna hear it from in Colorado. The screams.
Yeah.
There'll be a little echo in Phoenix.
I hope it's okay.
Yeah, that's the first time that's ever happened to me, having a package, you know, not sent or anything like that.
It's weird that it didn't even get out of Canada, you know.
I know.
Fucking post office, I don't know.
It's not any better out here.
That's the funny thing, too, for the amount of money you got to pay for the shipping. It's like, really? You're going to make me drive all the way out there to get it?
Yeah, really. I don't... It's weird. I mean, it's like, how did they... I mean, obviously they know what the hell it is so they could get a hold of you. So it's like they know where the damn thing came from.
Yeah, I know. Like, I'm really confused. I'm...
You know, it's like they can't just, like, bring it, you know, mail it back for crying out loud. It's just like, what?
Yeah, that's what I asked the girls. No, we need the original, you know, shipping receipt to give it to you. I'm like, oh, thank God I still have it.
Yeah. I mean, if it was just like the address and stuff was gone, they wouldn't even know where it came from. I mean, it just, this whole thing just makes no sense. I'll be interested to hear what you find out when you get down there. Yeah.
You know, I'm getting all riled up just talking about it.
Yeah. I don't blame you. What a pain in the ass. And then on top of that, you know, was
well,
it...
Well, now I'm going to have to contact... Well, assuming I can get the thing back, then I got to contact the customer and say, you know, I'm sorry, I'll throw you in a free print or something for the extra weight.
Yeah. Was it an eBay sale, too?
Yeah.
Which sucks, because, you know...
No, like, I don't want to get bad feedback.
Possible bad feedback if the guy, you know, is impatient or something. Fucking is ridiculous, man.
Oh, well, such is life.
Yeah.
Well, that Daredevil's coming along really nice.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, the customer watched the show yesterday, and he's all psyched about it, so I'm happy about that. It's true. I don't know. I want to make a print of this one for sure.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
Even though the movie is not my favorite one. But
the costume still looks good, though.
The costume definitely looks... When I was looking for the image of, like, what to do, there was, like, you know, all the Daredevils were coming up, and this is definitely, I think, the best costume.
Oh, by far.
So what it's are you funny, the movie isn't that bad when you start watching from the beginning, you know what I mean? It's like, there's like a couple parts that just derail the heck out of me in that movie, but...
Yeah, I still, I always say, you know, it's. I still think at that point they're still trying to figure out how to do superhero movies and without a whole lot of studio interference and stuff. And, you know, just the fact that they were able to make the costume look like it looked in the comics is something, you know.
Totally.
Nowadays, I think for the most part, a lot of times the studios will say, these movies are making money when you try to make them like the comic books instead of trying to make it, you know, something else. So why don't we just let you do your thing as long as it makes money, you know.
Yeah.
But back then, they didn't, it, you know, they had to, oh, this comic book, we can't make it like a comic book, or, you know.
Yeah, totally.
So, I don't know. It's one of the early ones, so, you know, it's not great, again, but, you know.
Well, I you know, found it, and I was watching it again, just for, like, to pull reference, even though I kind of ended up just taking this off of the web, but I don't know. I hadn't seen it for so long, I forgot, like, a ton of it. So I think Jay was asking what you're working on, Scott.
Oh, this
Young in the Dead.
Yep, this is page 14.
Oh, cool.
Out of I think there's 22 pages of story, so
that's what I was getting there. Yeah.
Yeah. It should start moving a lot faster. I just did.
For the mini comics at your convention, maybe you talked about it because that one show I kind of jumped in late. Did you sell a lot of those mini, like the preview comics?
I didn't. Well, those were just by request only.
Oh, okay.
And so it was either, you know, it was the people that were asking if I had issue 3 out, then I would show them that. And then a couple of people, if they really seemed interested, like if I, even if they hadn't got the other two, and I was pitching it to them, and they said, oh, really, and you're coming out with issue 3 soon? Sometimes I would show them that, and I said, you know, but they would just buy the first two, you know, just to know that I'm working on it, I guess, because some people just would rather have the actual finished copy than the preview. But the people that were asking about it, every single one of them, you know, ended up buying it because it was only $1, and there's $1 off of coupon for when the actual issue comes out. So, yeah, I mean, I didn't print a whole lot of them. Again, it was just to satisfy those people that have been patiently waiting. And I actually, I just filmed the latest. I got to upload it, but I just filmed the latest, like Beyond 100 Days of Making Comics update. But the cool thing, and I don't know if I did I talk. I may have talked. I know I've talked about it on my thing, but I don't know if I talked about this, but one of the things that surprised me was that a lot of the people that are, like, serious about the comic that really are waiting for the next one to come out are, like, younger kids or, like, teens.
Oh, yeah.
And to me, that's cool because it's not, I mean, the comic book is still, it's very in, you know, in the spirit of those 80s shows, so... And those don't always translate to younger kids. So the fact that younger kids and teens are love the story and everything.
Yeah, that's really cool.
To me, that's cool. Because I just thought my target market was going to be people that love Goonies and want to see stuff like that, you know.
Yeah, I know. That is neat. I actually love those preview comics, like ash cans, whatever you want to call them. I mean, anytime I can get a hold of one of those things... You know, I'm just all down with it, so I could see people buying that, you know.
And I've got, I mean, the deluxe version of the comic, that like the first issue, and there's one of the second, although I didn't have any printed up of the second issue for the con, but, you know, it just depends. Certain people want that, you know, the hand-touched one, and it's all cut out, and some people just want the story, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm definitely one who likes, you know, the crappier versions for some reason.
Well, yeah, in my case, it's, I mean, the ash cans in my case, they're better quality than the other ones.
Really?
Well, they're all, like, hand cut out and everything, and, like,
yeah.
I guess you'd kind of have to see it, but.
Yeah.
It's like if you were to have something like I'll die cut and everything, but I didn't die cut it, I hand cut it and everything, and, you know, it's all printed out by hand on my computer, on my, you know, printer. And
how much do you sell those ones for?
Those ones I sell for $8. Well, the first issue I sell for $8, the second I sell for $10 because it has an original sketch in it.
Oh, that's cool.
Quick sketch, you know.
Well, that's a decent price because, you know, I don't know. I love those kind of things, but then it's like, you know, when you see people like sell them for even like $5, it's like, you know, it doesn't almost make sense, especially if you're printing it yourself and, you yeah. know, like you don't want to do all that work and make like $1. You know?
Right.
So, at least with 10, you're making something there. You gonna try Comicsology? On like the digital comic sites when you get that thing done.
Yeah, I haven't really thought too much about it, but I should, you know.
You should. I mean, you know, it's like I keep hearing about like Amazon and all these authors who are like supposedly, you know, blowing up on like Kindle Direct and all that kind of stuff, and I just keep thinking like, man, it's like digital comics just seem like it should fit in there, but I haven't heard of anybody that's making that work, like, you know. I don't know.
It also has, I think it'll be different once I get that third issue out, because I don't know, because that's one of the things that Paul Roman Martinez was saying to me was he says, you know, it's one thing to have one book, and then two book, okay, but if you got three books, it kind of shows that track record, and he says that's, at that third book, it's going to be like you're definitely more serious than that you're putting these things out and everything, so.
Yeah. That makes sense. Cause nobody's gonna like do three freaking graphic novels or whatever, three comics even without being serious about it.
Right.
And even like when you buy comics out of the shop, you know, there was kind of like that, you know, because you know you'd see indie comics that were like one issue, and then you never see another issue ever. Yeah. It's like it took everything out of them just to get that one out. I can understand that. So Super Killer says, do I like working that large? And I think it's like my favorite size now. I was kind of, you know, working small for so long, I had a hard time getting back up to it. But now it's like, if I can get around this 12 by 17, I like that the best. Then Unmasked Arts in the chat. You can join my Patreon. Thanks, man. Femox, I don't know if I mentioned him yet. He's in the chat also. You going to try Diamond or anything? Once you get that Young and the Dead going? No?
I don't think so. Not unless I get something where like I get interest from somebody Image or something like that. I just don't think, yeah, you know, the scale I'm working at, I just don't think it's, I don't know, worth it. Maybe if, I don't know how Diamond works as far as trades, but if I get the trade done, you know?
Yeah.
But I don't know.
Well, it used to be like everybody's like first go-to, and it's funny, it's like down the list now.
Yeah.
People don't want to go through Diamond.
Well, I just don't think they're very friendly to indie creators, so screw them, you know. I don't.
Yeah. I think it's like you gotta, like, I think it's around 2,500 or something to even stay, like, in the catalog. Like, if you don't get that many orders, they don't let you do it, which that's pretty high, I would think. I remember I had a friend who self-published, or I had two friends, actually, back, you know, in the day, back in the 90s, they put a self-published comic out, and I'm pretty sure one of them came in at around 700, and the other one was like, you know, like 1,000 or something. So that's like, who knows what the market's even like anymore.
Yeah, I don't know.
Gonna run a Kickstarter for that book there?
I definitely want to, yeah. That's one of my, you know, goals when I get the trade done. And I want to, I'm hoping, like, because I want to, you know, I want to do, I want the trade to be, like, extra awesome with a lot of extras and things like that. So, like, I'd like to even run, like, a, like, you know, as a, what do you call them? Not incentives, but,
reward
goals or whatever that tier. If you hit that, what do you call that in Kickstarter? Where?
Oh, like the stretch goals.
Stretch goals, yeah. So, I mean, I would even like to have something where I could commission you to do like a cool painted cover, almost like you know how Goonies done, you know how you know Drew's Goonies, something like that.
Oh, where they're all hanging off the cliff or whatever.
Well, not that, but you know, it would be a different, you know. Yeah. Wouldn't be like a parody of that, but it was just, you know, something in that style, you know.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. I'd love to do that.
The only thing, I don't know, I mean, because it's, none of the characters are, like, I don't know if you have to work from photo reference for that, or if you would just draw them, or what would be easy for you to do, but.
I don't know. It'd almost have to be, like, we'd have to do a test, because you're right. It's like, we couldn't change them into, like, real people, so.
Well, I wouldn't, I mean, if, you know, that's even more money, but finding, like, if you find, like, models or just find pictures of, that we can use as reference that kind of look like what I would imagine them, but I don't know.
That'd be neat, yeah. I don't know.
But, yeah, I'd like to have something like that, like, either a variant cover or just, like, in the back have, like, other artworks, other people's interpretations of it, and have like, I don't know, maybe a special story that's only available, like a little spin-off story that's only available in the trade and not online, which nothing's available online yet, but that's another thing I want to do is, you know, start running it as a webcomic.
Yeah, webcomic would probably be a good idea to promote with, I would think.
Well, I mean, I started going down that route, and then I got that big project, and that took up so much of my time. So, I mean, some of the groundwork's already done there. And now I'm even further along with this, with the third issue. So I know if I get three issues done, I mean, that's a huge buffer. So I wouldn't feel, I mean, that's the one reason why I was waiting for to do the webcomic, because I didn't want to fall behind and not be able to update it. But, you know, if you got three issues, that's a pretty good head start, you know.
Yeah, that's true.
I still would probably, you know, it'd probably be better to update twice a week instead of once, but I don't know. I still, you know.
Yeah, it's tough. Two pages of comics a week, especially if you end up with any other work. It's like, whoa.
Well, I could do it, but then I'd still worry about it catching up to me, so.
Yeah. I don't know. Like Kickstarter, you know. I guess my opinion doesn't count, but it's like I would definitely fucking donate to get that sucker. I'd love to see it as a trade.
Yeah, yeah, and I'm hoping, you know, by that time, if I start running as a webcomic, I'll have a little bigger audience, and then, you know, people would actually, you know, want it and stuff, so. And by then, hopefully, I'll be doing more shows, and people will be more familiar with it and everything. We'll see.
Yeah, that's the cool part, and I've thought about that with me doing a book, is like, once you do a book as a Kickstarter, then you got some books to take to these shows, you know, which is really awesome.
Yeah.
Because, like, sometimes I'll bring, like, and I didn't do it this con, but, like, the last one, I print up, like, sketchbooks and stuff, but it's hard to make them cheap enough, you know? It's like, that's a super niche kind of person that's going to buy, like, you know, a $15 sketchbook that you basically just printed, and it's, like, all, like, saddle stitch, like, stapled, you know?
Yeah.
So.
When you say sketchbook, like, what do you mean? Like, you just got, like, line art in there, or?
Like, a lot of my drawings is what I put in that last one. I don't have one close, but. Yeah, I don't know. I just copied up a bunch of my drawings, and then I had, like, the color cover and black and white on the inside, so.
Oh, okay.
But it's still like, you know, I just stapled it myself. It was like, I don't know, 4 pieces of paper. So was that 16 pages or something?
Yeah.
So, and I was like asking like $15 for it. So it's not really like that great of a value. But it looked pretty cool, though.
Yeah.
people looked at it, but, you know, I think the price kind of put them off. But if you had a, you know, you ran a Kickstarter, you had a nice little book sitting there, I think you'd probably sell that all day, you know.
Oh, so actually they're talking about Diamond. Let me check this out. Is Diamond Distribution still a thing? Knew they were large back in 2000.
I'm pretty sure that's still how comic books order their comic book stores order their comics, so.
Yeah, I think like, you know, as far as getting into shops, like they're the only distributor now, and I think they're still like the, you know, the gate you gotta pass pretty much. Unless you're just like going direct to like different shops, which, you know, how could you do that?
I don't know what he means by this. Is you don't want Ellen Page mad at you? What's that mean? Who's Ellen Page?
She's an actress. She's, I think so. I think that's...
Why would Ellen Page be mad at us?
I don't know. I'm like scrolling back up. I don't see any more references to it. It must be a joke. I'm just not getting it. He'll chime back in a minute, I'm sure.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd love to see your comic as a... I mean, you know, this is all work you got to do, so of course I'd love to see it, but... like, your comic is a webcomic, too, though, because there's just, you know, I have a hard time finding, like, any webcomics that I'm really into, you know.
Yeah, it's definitely, you know, it's on the horizon. I don't know how far along it is, but it's something I'm going to do, so...
Yeah.
Yeah,
there's a lot of webcomics out there, but there's just not, like, that many awesome ones, you know?
Yeah, and I don't know, you know, just because it is a serialized story, I don't know how well that works either.
He says because of the Last of Us controversy? He's got Last of Us in quotes. I think we're missing it.
I know that's a video game, but I don't know what Ellen Page has to do with that, unless she's... Unless they're going to make it into a movie, or unless she does the voiceover, I don't know. I don't know anything about that controversy.
So Femox says, LOL, I so did not get that until you mentioned The Last of Us. Somebody explain it to me.
Yeah, Last of Us.
I don't get it. I like my friend Sean Tiffany's webcomic, Oil Can Drive. Everybody should go read that one.
That is really cool. Yeah,
it's not updating it, though.
Yeah.
The whole site's cool. The graphic design's cool. The art's cool.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, so Naughty Dog guys used her as reference for Ellie
and
Last of Us without consulting her and problems arose.
Okay, got it. That makes sense.
Yeah.
Ellen Page was, she was in Juno and I don't remember what else, but she's playing Kitty Pryde in, or maybe she already did. Was Kitty Pryde in the last X-Men? I don't know.
Yeah, I'm trying to even think. Like, the last X-Men one that I saw was like, it had the Game of Thrones little guy in it. Was that the last one?
I think so, yeah.
I don't really keep up on the X-Men movies.
No, I was kind of falling asleep through that one anyways.
Yeah, they're too bad.
I remember the Quicksilver scene. That was cool, though.
Yeah.
That was the best part of the entire movie.
Yeah.
Too bad Pete's not here to argue that fact.
Right.
Where is Pete at? You better be getting some work done, you sucker, if you're watching right now. That's all I'm saying. Better not be slacking. Superkiller says Inception. Was she in Inception?
Yeah, I think she's been in a lot of stuff. She's pretty recognizable. She's really, like, tiny and young.
Yeah. I'm bad about remembering, like, names of, like, modern actresses and stuff. Used to be awesome at it, but, keeping up with like TV and stuff, it's crazy, you know, because everything's not even on TV. You know, there's so much stuff on like cable, it's all these different places, and you know, I don't know.
Yeah, you ain't got time to be watching TV anyways, you're too busy painting.
That's right. Well, I mean, everything I watch like that is, it's, you know, I hardly watch it, I just listen to it, you know. If it gets so good that I have to watch it, I almost have to turn it off. They do stream like movies and stuff a lot of times while I'm working. I'm not talking to you guys. So, Lindro, let's talk some movies, I guess. You're missing out, Pete. Get back on the show, man. He says, I'm really not looking forward to the Fantastic Four movie.
Yeah, I don't know about that one.
Yeah. Yeah, who knows, though? I'll watch it just to see.
Yeah. Let's just, like, give all that stuff back to Marvel. I want to see their version of it now.
Yeah, pretty much.
Till they start screwing them up. I mean, you know. They're kicking out the best superhero movies right now.
Have you seen that new Avengers, Scott?
Yeah.
What'd you think of that?
I liked it. I mean, I guess I would just put it on par with the first Avengers, you know. I don't know if I liked it anymore, but yeah, it was just solid. It was definitely enjoyable, and you know.
Yeah, didn't you say you didn't like it, Jay?
Yeah.
Well, you didn't like it at all?
Yeah, I don't know. To me, I don't know. The whole movie just felt kind of, like, rushed.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's a little difficult to have all those people in a single movie, but I don't know.
I thought the first one was way better.
Oh, okay.
So that's just my opinion.
Yeah, I still haven't watched it. I need to do that.
It's one of those ones that, yeah, it's like I could have watched it already, but then I wanted to kind of watch it with everybody because Tristan loves the Avengers and all that. And we just haven't got around to it yet.
Have you seen Mad Max?
I haven't seen Mad Max either. I'm meaning to do that one too.
Have you seen it, Jay?
Not yet, no.
Oh, man, come on. What's wrong with you guys?
Because, you know, honestly, I don't get out to the theaters, you know. If I can watch it, if I can just download it or something, I'll definitely watch it. I'll see it as soon as I can get a decent copy of it, definitely. Yeah, maybe my dad will catch a Sunday matinee with me of Mad Max.
Yeah, because really, I mean, I would encourage you, if you're going to see a movie in the theater, see Mad Max in the theater, because it's just amazing, because it's, you know, most of it's all practical. I mean, these, you know, people jumping off cars and stuff, I mean, it's all real. I mean, it's just...
Oh, I know. I hear nothing but good things. Like, from everybody that's seen it, they say it's just, you know, an unbelievable movie. I'm dying to see it.
Well, that's kind of neat. So that's all, like, just there's not all a bunch of CG.
No, I mean, most of the special effects are, I mean, there, of course, there's, you know, they didn't actually lop, like, Charlize Theron's arm off, so that's CGI, but there's, you know, you know, all the stunts and stuff are all practical. I mean, it's just, and it's, you know, it's like one of those old movies, like, I don't know, like Ben-Hur or something, where they've just got all these people just all over the place, just you know.
Yeah.
Huge amount of cast going on and, you know, all, you know, it's, I don't know, it just, you just don't see movies like that anymore, you know.
That's cool.
And it, I mean, it doesn't look like a video game, like Avengers, yeah. Like a lot of that, some of it kind of looks like a video game.
Yeah. But,
you know, this, it just looks real, and I don't know, it's...
That's something I actually kind of don't really like when they do the CG, is the car stuff, which I know it's probably super easy for them to do it that way, but yeah, there's something so that... Big. Yeah. And they get so crazy, you know, like, I don't know, like a car wreck will be happening and like somebody will be jumping, like, from one car to another, like, you know.
Yeah, that's a bit Fast and Furious.
Yeah,
so in this, I mean, if it's got to be believable because it's actually happening, you know, I mean, it's the, you know, it's under a supervision and they probably planned it all out, so, I mean, it's, I mean, there's a little bit of, you know, it might not happen so perfect if it was in real life, if it wasn't all coordinated, but still, I mean, it is real, so it's, you know, it's not as far-fetched, really.
Yeah. Well, that's neat.
Yeah, check it out. I guess I've just been on the Hangout so much I haven't been watching anything lately. Kevin comes on here after the show's over, and we just, like, on here all freaking day.
Okay, yeah, we were on there, like, all day yesterday.
Yeah, Jess is in the chat. Hey, Jess, let's go, man. And then Superkiller says, I find having distraction while doing art really helps me creatively. And I actually 100% agree with that.
I don't like to just sit in silence and think about what I'm doing. I think it hurts my heart. I second guess myself too much. I'd much rather have a conversation while I'm drawing. Which is just weird, but...
Nah, it's not weird at all. That's why we're all here.
Yeah. I mean, I just... Yeah, I can't hardly do it. Yeah, why is that? I don't know. When that changed in me. Yeah, we were talking a little bit about Etsy before the show started.
Oh, yeah.
And all that. Is Scott still in here?
I'm here, yeah.
And I was, like, thinking, like, I wonder, are you going to try sticking your bow ties and stuff up on there?
Yeah, oh, definitely.
I would think, man, that that might be something that would rock, you know, with that audience.
Yeah. I'm sure there's a million other people selling bow ties on Etsy, but, you know, I think that plus all my other stuff, I mean...
Do you have an Etsy store right now?
Or I don't. Well, I've got there's not one up, but I've got my username and all that. It's, you know, so I'm... I just have to set it up.
Yeah. Because I will sell a few things off Etsy, and I always feel like if I ever had something that, like, they wanted...
Yeah.
Because, you know, like, that's the one thing different about Etsy than, like, Store Envy is, like, there is, like, that eBay kind of market there with people shopping. Whereas I think with, like, Store Envy, it's, like, you're really sending, like, all of the traffic to buy stuff, you know?
Right.
So you're not going to put the bow ties on your Store Envy? You're just going to do it
straight? Oh, no, they'll be on it. I'm going to put everything everywhere.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I figured, you know,
just double listed, yeah.
Many different places I can put stuff. I'm going to start, you know, expanding what I have on Redbubble, expanding what I have on TeePublic, you know, try some of these other ones. There's this, you know, Threadless, it's not launched yet, but they're going to have their own kind of marketplace thing like that. So
yeah.
I'm going to have my stuff on whatever I can.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of curious about the threadless, like once they get that going, like see
if it's
going to work or not.
Yeah. I never have messed much with those t-shirt sites. It's because it's like any kind of graphic design. It just puts me off. Like, I got to cut this thing out? You're kidding me.
Yeah. My stuff's kind of... My stuff is kind of designed more towards that, so.
Yeah, you're all about the design.
Yeah, I mean, I consider myself just as much of a graphic designer as I do an illustrator, so.
Yeah.
I mean, most of the work I do, I mean, that I get paid for, a lot of it's graphic design, so.
Yeah.
So what's the best way to, like, market your stuff on Etsy, or do people just kind of find you?
Man, I don't know, because I'm not very good at it, so. Oh, Chris Kitt, it says, hi, all. Can't believe my luck winning yesterday. Very cool. Everyone should sign up if they can. So, Chris Kitt, you're actually Chris Bunting on whatever? Is that who won it? Let me see, I got the card over here. No, I don't have it.
Did you do your drawing yesterday, then?
Yeah, Christopher Bunting was the name I drew. But then this guy, Chris Kitt, saying he won it, so. Way to go, dude. Let me know, because I was going to message you last night on Patreon and tell you. And, you know, tell you to pick something for me to draw, but I ran out of time with all my web stuff, but... Yeah, just let me know either on there or like even in the chat here, and I'll draw it like, you know, I don't know, probably like the 6th or 7th. We get past the end of the month, and then I'll have a little time to do a piece like that. Pick some movie stuff, though. I don't want to do like anything too hard, please. So... What were you going to say, Scott?
I was just going to ask if he had requested anything yet, but it sounded like he didn't.
No. I still got to do last month's, because like last month I did the month before. I actually need to do two this month and get completely caught up. Oh, hell yeah. He said Highlander. I'm on board there, man.
Oh, that's cool.
That'd be awesome. I've wanted to do some Highlander stuff forever. You want the main character, or you want, like, the Kurgan? I'm going to let you pick, because I don't want to sway you by my preferences. Okay, so he says, yeah, Jeff, a.k.a. Creation Studio Chris Bunting. So.
What was I going to say? Oh, yeah, I need to do... last month's winner, which was Michael Olson, I think his name is, and he wanted me to pick do a B.B. King drawing, so that'll be a fun one.
That's
different.
Kind of hard.
I'm just Michael. Curious how that's harder than, is it just because you're not...
The musical instrument is going to be. Those are always hard, guitars and I don't know. But yeah. I've done a few musicians. There was like one guy. That's all he used to commission me for was just like bands and musicians and stuff. And oh man, you know, it's like that Stevie Ray Vaughan piece was one of them. He got off of me and stuff.
Yeah, you gotta earn your money with those.
That's just you know, like, they're so hard, man.
Didn't B.B. King? Did he just pass away?
Yeah, not too long ago.
Just die. Yeah. It's too bad. He's an old guy, though.
Because I thought, I could be wrong, but I thought like Ben E. King passed away not too long ago too, so I was getting them confused. I could be wrong, but because I think Ben E. King, didn't he do Stand By Me? I don't know. I'm trying to remember.
Now, who was the guy who just died like real recently? I thought it was B.B. King, but...
Yeah,
it's just like 2 weeks ago or something.
That's what I'm saying, but I think it might have, that both of them may have passed away not too long ago, but I could be wrong.
That's one, even though it's hard, I almost, yeah, would like to do like a bigger piece, but I don't know if I will. I know that Michael Olson's up in Canada too, so then I gotta ship it to him also.
Well, it is a free drawing, right? Like you can't,
free one.
You can't kill yourself on it.
But I mean, that would make a kind of a cool print, you know. I don't know what I'll do, but I'm sure there's like a lot of really neat photos of that guy, you know.
I'm sure there's endless amounts of reference you could use, yeah, for sure.
Yeah. I don't know. Let's see if I get energetic when I get to it. What's this? I thought there was a poisoning suspicion related to B.B. King's death. Oh, you're kidding me.
Mm. I thought it was like, because he had diabetes. I thought it was like diabetic complications or something he had. Plus, he was old. God, he's...
Yeah.
I don't know. Could be wrong.
Yeah, he had to be up there like 70s, 80s, I would think.
Yeah.
So, but I have no idea. I didn't really hear anything more than just like, the, you know, when it was on the news that night. What's that? Oh, man. I think Jay's fooling around.
Yeah.
Well, you talk about something. What's on your mind, Jay?
The only thing on my mind is getting down to Toronto and figuring out what the hell's going on with this painting. That's all I'm thinking about.
Totally.
Yeah, after this, I've got to take my son down to hopefully get his license again, or his permit again.
He failed a couple times?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Oh, man. What a pain in the neck.
Yeah.
Did you yell at him about that?
He just overanalyzes everything.
Does like, he?
Yeah.
Thought they were like trick questions when they were just like, they weren't.
Kind of like that, yeah.
Yeah, because the permit, that's just the written test you got to do, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, make him stay that book.
Yeah, hopefully. We'll see.
I just remember, like, the drunk driving question was, like, the only one that ever would get me. Like, what's the drunk alcohol, you know? They always had that one in there.
Well, that's it. A lot of them are like statistical things that he's like missing or something, like, you know, how many, you know, I don't know.
Yeah.
How many car lengths behind somebody you have to be or something, you know, stuff like that. Or like, one of them was how much do you have to weigh to be in a child car seat before you can get out of it or something like that. And just like, how's he going to know that crap?
Yeah, I'd fail that miserably. I have no idea.
Yeah, I mean, I have kids and I don't even know that.
I don't think that's
Oh, man, Lindro. He says allegedly B.B. King's daughter poisoned him.
Oh, my God.
That sounds horrible.
Why not just wait till he dies?
How much longer could he make it? And then Chris Kitt says, leave it to you. They want it bigger. Depends on the cost, but... Well, I mean, yeah, I hate to do that with a free one, but yeah, if you wanted to make it cooler, we could up it a little bit.
I've been wanting to do like a Highlander piece for like a while, so that one would be neat. Yeah, we could do the sketch, and then, you know, if you wanted to go for the painting, that'd be totally cool. I'll think of some ideas. I'll just message you later on, like, Patreon or something. And then Lindro says the family state lawyer says the claims are false. He's into it, man. He is watching the case. I really hope that she didn't
poison him, because that's like, you know, how horrible is that, you know?
Like all that Rosetta stuff that happened with his kids and stuff. Sure. Not that they poisoned him, but...
No, they just tried to rip him off.
Right. I found, like, an interview. We were talking about that one day on here before, and I was kind of, like, did some searches on YouTube and actually found some interviews with that one son who did break into the museum and tried to steal the paintings, and... I don't know. It was like him and like the grandkid, like his own son, I guess, talking about, you know, their dad and stuff. And I don't know. It must have all got,
you know, washed under the bridge or something. Cause
I don't know.
So there was like no real explanation as to what happened there. Or?
No, there was never any. I really looked around and tried to hunt and could never find anything.
I think it eventually just kind of went away.
But, I mean, basically, like, the one son, Frank Jr., was saying that he was, like, trying to keep the other kids from selling the paintings, basically.
Well, there's a hell of a way to do it. Yeah. Just steal them.
Which might have, you know, I mean, when you look at what happened once Rosetta died and his wife died, I mean, it's kind of what they've done, you know. Yeah. Like, we were talking about that one auction that's going on.
Yeah, I totally forgot about that. I gotta check up on that.
Frazetta opposed to selling his work?
Oh yeah, they never sold hardly any of the paintings. Oh,
okay. I see that.
It was mainly the mom, you know, Ellie Frazetta, was just really against any of that, keeping the collection together. And then when she died, you know, because she actually died before Frazetta did, and then he died like about a year later or something. But yeah, I mean, you know, as soon as, like, you know, Frazetta was dead, like, yeah, a bunch of them got sold, and then...
Oh, okay.
There's, like, a... You know, I don't think it's an auction, but it's an art show in New York, like, right now. But me and Jay have been kind of, like, looking at, just kind of wondering what's going on there, and they're selling, like, the Death Dealers up for sale there.
Yeah.
And, like a couple others, but I mean, they're like, you know, just blew me away seeing the Death Dealers, like, you know, because that's just such, like, you know, I mean, I could see him selling some of the more minor works, but like that one, for Christ's sake, that's almost like his most famous painting, you know?
Yeah. Now, was there only like one Death Dealer painting, or did he do a series with that same kind of character?
He did a series later on, but the one that's up is like the one that's super famous where he's on the horse.
Right. Oh yeah, I know.
Yeah, everybody knows that one.
Yeah, but how awesome would it be to actually own that painting?
Oh man. Yeah, if I was like, you know, Bill Gates or something, Microsoft, I'd totally buy that thing.
I think that's gonna sell for just an obscene amount of money.
I would hope so. I remember they were saying, like, you know, I mean, they sold a couple of the Conans, or at least one of them, and the one they were talking about on this, like, Frazetta forum, they were saying it was, like, basically millions of dollars, so.
Oh, yeah.
I would think it would have to be. I don't know. I don't know how I feel about it. I mean, in a way, it's kind of like, I guess they got to go to collectors, or they're going to, you know, it's not going to go on forever there at the museum.
Yeah.
So,
No, I really think it's inevitable. Like, somebody is going to have to own it eventually.
Right.
But it really surprised me. You'd think they would have cleaned out, like, all the minor ones and the less ones and just hold that one back, you know?
I'm sure the kids want to have one absolute massive payday from that one.
Yeah, somebody else said that. You know, it's like you never know what their finances are or what they're doing or, you know. I mean, maybe you just don't know. Maybe they're broke or something. They need some cash, man. And that's like one way to get it. But there's like a bunch of drawings and stuff because I clicked through that, you know, that site where they're showing that stuff. And there's a bunch of figure drawings that I've never seen before in there. All the drawings are like, you know, 6,000 or 8,000 up, you know what I mean, that they're really high. There's like a couple roughs. Wow. Like those little tiny watercolor roughs you used to do for the paintings. And they're up there pretty high.
But it's pretty cool. Did you go look, Jay?
No, I honestly completely forgot about it until you just brought it up now. I'm gonna have to check.
Yeah. I kind of forgot a little bit too, and then I was over like at that comic art fan site doing something, and that ad popped up again. I'm like, oh, I'm gonna go see. But I guess the actual show has already went by. So, oh,
really? So like the auction's over?
Well, they didn't auction them. They're just for sale. It's basically like, you know, inquire that, you know, like they have prices for the cheaper ones.
So, like does it say if they're sold or not, or they just didn't sell them?
They're not sold yet. They're for sale right now.
Okay.
Because it's like, you know, it has like an inquire button.
So they're just waiting for the highest bidder to pitch in.
They're waiting for, yeah, to get the money they want, I guess.
I thought maybe it was like going to be set up like kind of like a Christie's art auction or something.
I thought it was going to be an auction too, yeah, but apparently not. I don't know.
I'll slip Jeter Burns in there. He's a big Frazetta fan. Robert Rodriguez has brought a lot of... Oh, has bought a lot of the paintings and had a small Frazetta showing in Austin, Texas. Oh, that's super cool. Did you go see that, dude? The Artcaster's Facebook page has an art in sale section. Yep, in where we do. Oh, Super Killer says, where can I look up the art for sale? I have to find the link. I'm not even sure what the gallery is called. Maybe I'll just do it quick. And then Themox says, those sales of the Frazetta's work are going through the museum website. And I don't know about that. I mean, I know they sell some stuff from there, but maybe they're selling the paintings on there too. But this is actually it's a gallery in New York. I'll try to find the link real quick. Because I've seen like, you know, on the Frazetta site them selling, you know, drawings and all that stuff. I've never seen them having the paintings up for sale. But maybe it is. I haven't been over there for a while. Okay, cool. Yeah, it actually popped up. Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, here we go. It's called the Metropolis Gallery NYC.com. I don't know if I'll be able to put that in a link in the thing, but let me try to get the top and the front off it. Okay, so there it is, but I couldn't put .com on it, but basically just stick a .com on there and you guys can go see it. It's like right on the front page. So. Yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to that Rodriguez Fire and Ice movie. I know we've talked about that already, but since Gibran's bringing him up.
Yeah, he's Rodriguez is doing something that, well, they're in, who knows if it'll actually happen, but something that I've been kind of hoping for slash dreading forever, and that's a Johnny Quest movie.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Really? Yeah, so, I mean, I'm a little confident with Rodriguez just because in addition to doing, you know, his, you know, kind of movies he's known for, he also did, like, the Spy Kids movies, so if he kind of takes both those and kind of combines them, I just don't want him to, I don't want him to, like, cast some teenager as Johnny Quest. You know, I don't want him to be a kid, you know, like he was in the show. You know, because the last one they were going to try to do was, like, they're going to cast Zac Efron as Johnny Quest.
Oh, and, man.
Oh, that's
and The Rock is Race Banyan. And I'm like, that was the, that's, so hopefully, that was an old version. So hopefully, it's Rodriguez and the guy that's writing it actually wrote Pirates of the Caribbean and, like, Mask of Zorro and stuff. So that gives me a little confidence that it could be good, you know.
That guy who wrote Mask of Zorro actually wrote Pirates of the Caribbean. That blows me away.
Yeah.
Because I just thought that Mask of Zorro was such a lame movie.
Oh, you didn't like that? I thought it was good.
Did you? That's funny. Because, yeah, like, I love Pirates of the Caribbean, but, yeah, I couldn't dig the Zorro movie.
Okay.
I couldn't get into it.
But yeah, that's, I don't know what I think about that. It's like, I almost think he could do like a cool version, but then it's like, I don't want to see the Spy Kids version, you know what I mean?
Well, I'm only saying Spy, I don't think you would do it like Spy Kids, but you know, kind of combine the two, because it's, I mean, you look at him doing Spy Kids, and then you look at him doing like Death Proof, or what's the one he did, was it Death Proof or the other one, or Machete or anything like that. I mean, those are two completely different kind of movies. So somewhere in the middle there, I think you can find Johnny Quest. And I think just I just think Robert Rodriguez, if he's going to do it, I think he's going to try to capture what it's all about, because that's what he does with like his Grindhouse stuff, is he's trying to capture like the 70s feel. So if he, I don't know. I can kind of see it, than I thought. Because it's that really is like the one movie that I always wish they would do if they would do it good, but I just always been nervous that they'd screw it up. But
yeah, I'd love to see it if they did it like awesome. But it's like, man, that's like one that, because it's just got that, you know, kid audience. I could just see them like Disney-fying it.
Yeah,
you know?
I mean, it's like Indiana Jones before Indiana Jones and James Bond all rolled into one. You know,
totally.
So. Did you guys ever see, even if they did like an anime, which I doubt they'll do, but like, did you guys ever see the Tintin movie?
Yeah. I liked it.
Yeah.
That was, you haven't seen it? That was pretty awesome.
My son, we got that one on DVD, and he freaking loves that movie, and I like that one too. Yeah, because, I mean, it felt like Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
Know? Even the, and like I was not on board with like the animation like being that real, and it gives you that Uncanny Valley stuff, but I don't care that I don't like the animation. I love that movie.
Yeah.
But in some ways I'm almost like, why did they bother with animating it? It just seems like they could have just.
That's what I was thinking too. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, so they said some of the cheaper ones have prices. This girl watercolor, $6,500. Yeah. So somebody, it says most of the more interesting ones are call. So somebody call.
So you can.
I don't know how much the death dealer is.
You say $500. You can get a Frazetta original for $500. Is that what I heard?
No, $6,500.
Oh, $6,500. Okay.
And when you see them, it's like, you know, they're not even like, you know, like the pen and ink sketches. They're just super rough.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Type stuff. Here's a little watercolor, you know. But it's pretty wild, though. Yeah, who's important enough to get the, we need some big, Jay, you should call the gallery. Maybe they give you the price on the dealer, death dealer.
Oh, yeah, they know who I am.
Yeah.
You probably have to, like, put, write a check for, like, $50,000 just to get the price.
I wouldn't doubt it. I wouldn't be surprised.
They put a hold on your credit card for $1,000 just to get the quote.
Yeah, see, Superkiller says, I can't believe the ones they have for sale. That's, like, my thing, man.
It just seems like that, like those are big pieces. I'm amazed they're selling it. You think that would be the one you hold out for? Did you ever see that Johnny Quest stop motion thing that guy did a while back?
No.
Guy, and he basically redid the, it's really cool. I'll try to find it for you after the show, but
yeah, let's see this.
Yeah, it's like, he redid the, like the first part of it, what do you call that thing? Like the opening. But he did it in like stop motion. So it's like got all the scenes, it like cuts from this to that. And he did it like super like, like right on the money and true to it and has the music and,
I want to see that.
It was really neat, yeah. It got kind of viral, so I thought you might have seen it, because I remember, when I was all into doing the stop motion, he was making it, and he'd, like, kind of release each scene as he did it. So, there's a scene where, the mummy is in there, and, the ceiling falls down on him, and he just, put that little scene out, and it was, everyone was so cool. Yeah. But it got when he finally got it done and kind of like put it out on the internet, it went sort of viral. I was seeing it like everywhere. But
wonder how I missed that.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it didn't go as viral as I thought. So Femox says there are some unsigned ones as well, and they sell for like $1,300. Are those some of those life drawings that are in there? Yeah, Van Cringe or whatever is in the chat. Hey, man. Yeah. I don't know. It'd be wild. I'd like to know how much, but they keep all that shit under wraps. I remember, when the Conan painting got sold, it's just all rumors, Nobody really knows. But there's there's always been the stories for years where I think Sylvester Stallone tried to buy some of the Conan paintings at one point, and I know the Cat Girl is a story that's been around for years where Dino De Laurentiis was offering Rosetta $1 million for that one, and he wouldn't take it.
That's even just amazing that someone could offer you $1 million for your painting and you say, no, no thanks.
Well, when you look at, Bill Watterson, who did Calvin and Hobbes, and, he does no licensing at all. The amount of money and everything for whatever, film rights or all that stuff for Calvin and Hobbes,
Yeah, you'd be a freaking billionaire through that.
Yeah, but he's just, that's his, he has a stance about that stuff, and
I don't know.
I admire him for that, but I don't know.
I like my paintings, but I like them even more when they're sold.
Yeah.
In some ways, I kind of respect the Frazettas for doing that, though, because his art is so iconic, and it's kind of cool that they had him to make the museum and stuff. You know what I mean? I think that's the one thing where it's when I see them selling it, because everybody sells their art, so who cares, right? But it's sometimes when I see them selling out the collection, the kids selling it off, that's the thing I think of sometimes, is it was cool that they were all in one spot and that they were
in a museum, you know. I don't know. Yep. Instead of sort of scattered. Because they are, to me, like, they are, like, super iconic. I mean, they, like, you know, that is fantasy art right there, man. Yeah, Jesse Cobb said the stop-motion Johnny Quest intro was awesome. And it was freaking awesome. You should find a link, Jesse, if you can find it somewhere and stick it in the chat.
Sure. Search for it and find it.
And he says, yeah, they're also selling some Bernie Wrightson stuff. And I saw, yeah, there's a Bernie Wrightson piece on there. It's pretty high up, if I remember right. Oh, Van Cripps, he has this. Yeah, I'm calling you Van Cripps, but that's just because I can't pronounce it. He says, I have a hard name. That's cool, though. That's cool. Yeah, I got that page sitting open. His art is so fucking awesome, though. See, and actually, they do have the other Death Dealer, or one of the other ones, too, where he's, like, stabbing the guy with the spear, and it's kind of like all the fires behind him. That one's a great one, too, but it's not as famous. There's the one of the Death Dealers. I mean, it's like, it's hard to beat that one where he's on the horse, but one that I have always loved is the one where he's got the axe, and he's kind of like, he's got the axe over his head, and he's like fighting all the guys that are coming, you know, and kind of like the half circle from below. See, and they also have like the one, like where, like the Tarzan, and he's fighting the panther. I don't know if you guys are all as familiar with it as I am, but that's like another super famous one. What'd you say?
They like ring a bell when you start mentioning them. You know, yeah. Picture them.
Yeah, because they got the show page. Let's open this up. But they don't. No, they actually do have Princess of Mars in there too. That is fucking crazy. That's like the most famous, you know, one of all. It's like the one where he's got the sword over his head and, you know, the girl's like on his knee and, you know, they're standing over the Tharg on the ground with the moons behind him. I mean, to me, like, that is fantasy right there.
Yeah, is that the one where they parodied for, like, the vacation?
Yeah.
Vacation poster?
That's it. I mean, what's that sucker bring, man? That's just nuts. Yeah, I don't know how I feel about it. I guess it's good. And then they got this one, like, it's funny, like, this one that doesn't even have a figure in it. It's just, like, a little landscape with a tree. Never seen that painting. You think you found, like, all the Frazetta stuff, and then there's always, like, you know, on the web, a few more pieces pop up here and there. It's freaking awesome. He's like an artist, like whenever I see like new stuff, you know, it's like you kind of forget, you know, you've seen like it all forever, and every now and then you'll find like a new one, and it'll be like, oh yeah, it'll just be like that old Frazetta feeling back, like, yeah, yeah, I know, I remember why I liked this guy. But some good stuff. Painted that in 1973. It's cover for Flashing Swords, I guess. That's what Death Dealer was on. I was just reading the little description. 16x24. It's not that big of a piece, really. Anyway. And Lindro says, isn't it usually the grandchildren who sell off the legacy? Yeah. And then Jesse actually threw that YouTube link in the chat for that Johnny Quest thing. You can grab it there.
Let me go to...
Gibbering. He's like, they're selling off this legacy, those greedy bastards. Like, they're not making enough money off the clothing lines with his art on it.
I think that's honestly why Frazetta just, you know, never really needed to sell his paintings, because I think the prints, you know, like those prints probably sold so well that he got rich off them, and he could like hold out for, you know, over $1 million on like Catgirl and stuff. And Tom Artist says, better to sell off his legacy to collectors than keep it if they don't care. At least the collectors might look after it. And that's a really good point. That's a super good point. And, you know, because you're right. I mean, that's like what a few people have said is like, you know, if they're not into like keeping the museum going and stuff like that, it's like the guys who are going to spend that kind of money on those pieces, are they're going to keep it around and keep it alive, you know. So, yeah, I don't know. I guess it's just the fact that they never sold any. That's why it's kind of shocking. I mean, they used to sell the drawings and stuff, but like the major paintings, you know. I only seen one in real life. I remember seeing one Frazetta out in San Diego one year. They had, like later on he did this, like another version of like the Princess of Mars one. And the guy doesn't have the sword up, he's just kind of standing there. And it has a girl in it, and I think the moons are behind him still. And that was pretty amazing to see. See one in real life, you know. I never have been out to the museum. I always want to go out to the museum, though. But Scott watching some Johnny Quest.
That's why I've got it on a separate thing, but it's not. I'm gonna wait till after the Artcasters and watch it. But it's I got the link, so it's ready to go.
All right, cool. Well, it's about 11, so let's jump off. And so, Scott, what's your website, dude?
You can find me on the internet at circworks.com and circworks on YouTube.
That's awesome. Go get some bow tie stuff.
Well, they're not up yet, but they will be soon, hopefully. I'll let you guys know.
Cool. But you got your Store Envy site up. You got your comics and stuff in there, right?
Yeah, oh, there's stuff on there.
Yeah. Which actually, I've never bought your comic yet. I should do that. Okay, Jay, what's your website? If he's muted, he might actually be talking to somebody.
Yeah.
Airheadcustom.com with a Z is his website. And he also has like a YouTube channel, all that kind of stuff. And all the links are in the show notes below, so you can, you know, hit his site from there if you want to check out his stuff. And I'm Jeff Lafferty. JeffLafferty.net is my website. And I have Patreon. If you always want to support the show, head on over there. And thanks for watching, and we'll see you guys tomorrow.
See you.